Hello and welcome to today's overview of performance-based hiring for managers and interviewers. My name is JJ. I'm the Director of Operations for the Adler Group. Today's overview will be led by Brian Johansson. Brian is the COO of the Adler Group. He's also a master trainer and senior consultant. So without any further ado, Brian, go ahead and take it away.
Thank you, JJ, and welcome everyone to our overview of performance-based hiring for managers and interviewers. What I'm going to do is give you a quick, very short overview of some of the key concepts in performance-based hiring. As you may or may not know, Lou Adler is the founder and creator of performance-based hiring. His most recent book, The Essential Guide for Hiring and Getting Hired, really encapsulates and expounds most of the principles that we're going to talk about today. So I would highly recommend downloading that or getting a copy of it and taking a look. One of the questions you have to ask yourself as a leader, a manager, has to do with the quality of the talent you're really attracting. And there are a couple of questions here. Does the quality of the people you attract represent the best in the field? When you look at a slate of candidates, you should be asking that question. Is this the best in the field? Is the quality of the people you attract better or worse or the same as the people currently in your company? There are really only three outcomes when you hire. You elevate the quality of the people in your company, meaning you hire somebody better than the people you've already got within the company. You hire people who are pretty much the same as the people who are already there, or you hire people who are not as good, and that actually lowers the quality of your team. We look at companies through the lens of how well they're attracting top 25% talent, the A-team. And what we find is people who they're generally attracting, people who apply to the advertising online, those people, there's a very small percentage of them that fall into the top 25%, and there's a huge percentage that fall in that bottom three quarters. So the goal is to attract and hire the best people. This is really the promise and the potential of performance-based hiring, and I'm going to show you a little bit about how we can do that. Now, in order to do that, you have to understand a little bit about what the best people do differently, because our contention is that the best people have jobs. They're not that necessarily active in the marketplace. They don't need your job. They're not going to change jobs just to get another job. They're going to change jobs because the job is something they really want to do. They're very motivated to do it. So if you look at the attributes, the characteristics of top talent, and you look at these things that we've got on the screen here, they consistently exceed expectation. They coach, manage, self-develop others. They demonstrate leadership vision. They are good at problem solving and thinking. They are flexible. They fit within the culture. They fit with the manager. And they get stuff done with no excuses. One of the questions we ask is, if we had somebody who met all of this criteria, would you want to see them? And the answer is always, yeah. If somebody was like that, I would want to see them. Well, we're going to talk about how we get to these people, how we attract these people, and how we don't exclude them. Because I will tell you, most hiring processes exclude a lot of people like this for the open positions just by the nature of how we advertise them, where we put them, what we ask these candidates to go through in the process. Managers are not fully aware of their importance in hiring top talent. Top talent won't work for an average or below average manager. They want to work for a manager that's going to be above average and invest in them and someone they can learn from. So we're going to talk about how that plays out in the whole hiring process. This methodology is called performance-based hiring. And this was developed by Lou over literally 30 years of executive search and actually benchmarking great managers and how they interview and assess and hire top talent. There are four areas that have to be right for that to work, and these are the essence of the course and performance-based hiring. One, you got to have a great job, and it's got to be articulated as a great career move. You've got to know where the best people are, and you've got to source the best talent. You've then got to be able to interview them and get deep enough to understand how they do what they do. We call it the two-question performance-based interview. And then you've got to recruit them. And that recruiting involves recruiters and managers working together as a team in order to close top talent. What I'm going to do now is introduce you to some of the concepts in performance-based hiring as we teach them in the course. One concept is very simple. Make the job spec equal to the real job. Most of what we see posted by companies is what we call job descriptions having requirements. Lists of must have 5 years, must have this, must have a BSEE degree, must have a MBA from a top school, must come from our industry, a lot of must-haves, must know TCPIP, must know whatever it is, we spec a job in terms of having, which, by the way, is not a job. It's just a list of requirements. One of the first things we teach in the course is let's spec the job in terms of what success looks like. What does someone who is successful in this role have to accomplish in order to be considered great? That's a performance profile, and we teach the methodology for doing that. That changes the entire game in hiring. Once you understand what success looks like, now you can use that to attract top talent, and you can use it to assess top talent. The key here is, it is not what you have that matters. It's not the degree you got. It's not the 5 years of experience. It's what you did with that degree. It's what you did in that 5 years with that company that matters. That's the difference maker. Now, next is an understanding of what you're trying to do in an interview. When I ask managers, what's the purpose of an interview? All of them say it's to see if anybody's any good, assess competency and motivation. Well, yes, that's true, and it's very important, and we should do that. But we also have to do other things. We have to demonstrate professionalism. We have to recruit and close a candidate, and we have to create an opportunity gap. Just so you know, and this is what we describe in the course, the opportunity gap is really the difference between what a candidate is doing now in their current job or any other potential jobs they may be going after and what they get to do in your job. And a great interviewer will know how to create that gap in the interview by identifying that gap and then pushing back a little bit on the candidate. It's one of the techniques we teach in the course. And that's all I can really go into today about that. Now, interviewing tends to be fairly inaccurate. One of the questions we ask is, how accurate is the one-on-one employment interview? Lots of research on this, but at the end of the day, it's only about 57% accurate, 7% better than flipping a coin, and there are a whole lot of reasons that we go into in the class. These reasons are the reasons we hire average or below average people. Our goal is to address each of these and give you the tool sets to be able to identify top talent, which is both competent and motivated. By the way, the number one hiring mistake is to hire someone who is competent. They are capable of doing the work. They're just not motivated to do the work. It's not work they enjoy, they're interested in, they like, or they're going to learn from. Now, we have an 8-step interview process. In the middle of that 8-step process is probably the most important interview question you'll ever get, and I'm going to introduce you just to the concept of that. I won't have time to go through all the other 8 steps. There are really 2 core questions. I'll just mention one of them. But I'm going to go into a little bit of depth on the first one. We call this the MSA question, the most significant accomplishment question. Very simple. You turn to the candidate and you ask, tell me about your most significant accomplishment, something you've done in a professional setting that you're very, very proud of. We then teach deep fact-finding because we want you not only to get the 10,000-foot, here's what I did, we want you to get the 0 feet, here's how I did it, here's who I did it with, here's how I collaborated, here's where I really made a contribution, all of those things. And we do that with these types of fact-finding questions. What's the project? Give me a snapshot at the beginning and the end. What were the challenges? How did you overcome them? And so on and so forth. One of the things we really try to do is figure out what work they like. What about the project or the things they've delivered did they really enjoy? And were they recognized by somebody for having done that? Now, that opens us up to really get an understanding of what they've done compared to what we want done. Remember, we've defined what success looks like in our performance profile. Now we get examples of things they've done and we can start to compare. Is it bigger, smaller, bigger scope, smaller scope, more technical, less technical, more people, less people, collaborative, non-collaborative, whatever it is, we get to compare accomplishments in this way. That's the power of the MSA question. Now we then teach interviewers to ask about individual accomplishments, team accomplishments, accomplishments in different periods of time, and job-specific accomplishments. You can spend an entire hour interview just asking about accomplishments and then relating it back to the work that needs to be done. That is a powerful question. We used to call this the one-question interview. By the way, the second question, which we can't cover in the overview, is about job-specific problem solving. Equally as powerful and very, very insightful. You'll have to come to the course to get that one. Now, one of the things that's interesting to me as we go about training, many managers go into an interview, conduct an interview for an hour or 45 minutes, walk out of the interview, and they don't know whether they should hire the person or not. Part of the reason they don't know is they're not sure what criteria to use. They're not very objective about the evaluation. So one of the tools we give you is the Quality of Hire Talent Scorecard. This has been designed over many years to encapsulate the core capabilities that a person needs to do in order to be successful in a role, and we have a 1 to 5 scale, and the goal is to help you be much more objective and much more focused in a debriefing session. So that's the tool set. Performance-based hiring for managers and interviewers is really designed to give managers the capabilities that they need in order to hire top talent consistently. That includes defining the work, that includes partnering with your recruiter to be able to find top talent, that includes interviewing that top talent, assessing that top talent, and ultimately closing top talent. Those are the things that managers need to be great at. And part of that includes being able to articulate why the job is a good career move for somebody. We call that the employee value proposition. I hope you will join us online for performance-based hiring for managers. We've just launched this course online. The quote you see on your screen is from a book that just came out, The End of Average, from Todd Rose, who's a professor at Harvard. He is the director of the Center for Individual Performance, and he has evaluated performance-based hiring and believes that this is the key to getting top talent into your organization. So I would recommend taking a look at the book and certainly looking at his quote. So three things that you can do to take action. First, join us online for performance-based hiring for managers and interviewers. The first course of our online version actually starts this month, and I would recommend that you check out the schedules online. We have a course once or twice every month. We do private trainings, and if you'd like to discuss that, feel free to drop us an email at info@lewadlergroup.com, and we can discuss the possibility of coming to your organization and doing a training. And finally, if you are a leader and you have many hiring managers or interviewers reporting to you, and you would like to audit one module of our performance-based hiring for managers course, drop us an email at info@lewadlergroup.com and say, I'd like to audit. We'll give you a call and we'll arrange for you to have a chance to audit one of the modules of that training. Thank you for joining us today, and we hope to see you online or in a private training soon.
Great. Thank you, Brian, and thank you for joining us. If you have any questions about this program or any of the other classes or services provided by the Adler Group, please send us an email at info@lewadlergroup.com. We look forward to seeing you in future webinars and classes. Have a great afternoon, everyone. Bye-bye.